Friends, I present to you the master, Paramahamsa Yoganandaji.
It has been a gala day for us to have the governor and his wife and such wonderful celebrities and wonderful souls who have come for far and near for this occasion that I am overwhelmed. I will not try to give you a philosophical discourse, for they are usually very obtuse. As often some doctors say, the operation was successful, but the patient peacefully died on the table. I don't want to give a deep philosophical discourse, but I will give you a few stories that you will always remember in course of my lecture today. About art of living, I think art of living is more or less everywhere the same. Human nature everywhere is the same. No matter what different kinds of clothes we wear, what different religions we follow, what different environments we live, we have the same problems to fight, and we must remember that we are all made in the image of God, and if we believe in the Christian Bible, we come from the same parents, Adam and Eve. And as such, we must recognize the unity of mankind. But the trouble is this, that everything, when we look beyond the horizon of our own experience, it seems grotesque. The East speaks of the West as heathens, West speaks of the East as the heathens, and so forth. But it is only by the constructive exchange of experiences that we can get together. I remember once, I don't dress myself, I don't emphasize dress. I say, make your heart a hermitage of God, a hermitage of prayer, a hermitage of His blessings. Dress doesn't mean anything to me. I have paid for this dress. 3 years I used to walk this way in Boston, because they insisted in India that I should get the Bostonians educated to the dress, but it was hard time educating 2 million people, and I had apples on my back and everything. And I must tell you a very amusing story. It was in a Boston food show. Dr. and Mrs. Lewis were my earliest friends, and they were there. And after they gave me something sticky to eat, I wanted to wash my hands. So I asked one of the ushers where to go. So I went in. When I went in, there were ladies to the left, ladies to the right, ladies front and behind. And I didn't dare to. I was smoothly shaven. Nobody at all suspected me. But if I galloped away, I would be suspected. So with the greatest ease, I came out of it, of the place. So after I came out of the place, I asked another usher, where was the gentleman's restroom? He points out to the ladies' restroom again. I says, I mean it, where is the gentleman's restroom? When he heard my voice, he looked up and down, he couldn't understand. So I was going very happily down. A man comes, he says, lady, upstairs, upstairs, upstairs. I said, shut up, I know where I'm going. What's the matter with you? He didn't know what to say. That's not the end of this story. When I went, where 20 people were washing their hands, and I started washing my hands, they looked at each other this way, and they just like birds flew out of the place in 1 second. I had all kinds of troubles about the hair. I keep this hair because my master had it. The boys don't have the long hair. They all wear the American dress. I wear the American dress. I have a wonderful way how I braid my hair and fix it up. You won't know that I have long hair. Because of all these troubles, I had to, as I said, that when you are in Rome, you must do as the Romans do. And I like the American dress. It is so simple. And this is a dress only for spiritual occasions. But the heart is what is to be changed. Our boys and girls and men and women, I let them dress as Americans, but their hearts are different. They receive no salary. They receive no wages. They receive only a pocket expense. But I had shown them, proved to them, the art of living. Art of living means that we must be happy abundantly, and we must have the necessary necessities of life, not the unnecessary necessities. We must be abundantly healthy. When I met Mr. Alvin Hunsicker in New York, he was the president of Standard Textile Company and was a very ardent follower of ours. He at first spoke of yogis, of sword swallowing and crystal gazing. I said, listen, crystals were always imported in France and Western countries. The Hindus never knew how to make crystals. But they're always blamed about crystal gazing. Crystal gazing is look to your spiritual eye. That's what they mean, to your inner eye. Whenever you always think at this point. Whenever you are eating, you are concentrate on your palate. When you are thinking, you are concentrating here. So it is that we must remember that everything that is in the east and the west and the north and the south, we can only understand by constructive exchange of our experiences. But the trouble is, I'll give you an illustration which proves that because we are certain habits, national habits are imposed upon us, we think that is the criterion and standard of living. You take an American baby and put him in a Hindu home, after 20 years, he will like Hindu hot curries, he will salute and he will be shy. And you take an American baby, I have seen American babies grow here, and they will say okay and go ahead, and they will be perfect Americans. But beneath these outward customs and conventions, there are certain eternal verities of conduct which leads us, which makes us what you should be. The real art of living consists in abundantly being happy, reasonably prosperous, and abundantly healthy. But the thing is this, when we grow one-sided, we always like to remain one-sided. Once I was coming to Los Angeles, and I was to be received by many students, so I had my dress this way. And in front of me was a movie actor. He was no other but Warner Roland. But seeing my long hair and this dress, he was very disgusted and making faces at me. So of course, I wasn't angry at all. I wanted to make him happy and feel relieved of the prejudice he had. So I said, pardon me, why do you make such a face? He said, none of your business. I said, of course it's my business, because every time I look in front of me, I have to see your face. Well, he laughed. He said, you seem to be very audacious sort of person. Who are you? I said, that's just it. That's the greatest opportunity for you and me today. You know, crazy people of the same kind mix with the same kind of crazy people. That's why they don't find out their craziness. That's where self-realization fellowship comes. Fellowship of nations and all people. So I said, I know about your craziness. I have seen you on the screen and I like your acting. But you don't know about my craziness. But at the end of, you know, when people differently crazy come together, then they find out their craziness. And at the end of a constructive exchange of experience, if you can convince me that your ways of life is better, I will be a movie actor. And if I can convince you that my ways are better, you ought to follow me. She said, all right. Every time he was trying to argue, but I kept one way open for him. I said, whenever it was truth, we must agree. 2 and 2 make 4, God says 5, it can't be 5, because God made 2 and 2 4. So in the end, after a long discussion, he lost out. I was saved from being a movie actor, and he followed me. I have a beautifully autographed picture, and in the end they said in the studio that he was drunk. He wasn't drunk. He told the director, I am going away. And the director asked, what for? He said, never to come back again. I am going to Sweden to lay my body. He was very developed though. And he said, I never liked the part that they asked me to portray. So he went to Sweden and laid his body there consciously. He was a great, great soul. So we must always remember that fellowship is necessary to find out the deficiencies of the habits that have been imposed upon us during a plastic state of our mind. But the prejudices, you have heard lots of things about India and other countries, but you don't know. I'm going to tell you something what I heard about you when I came here. My aunt warned me that in America there are so many Indians floating around the street that they would scalp me. And pardon me for saying this, it doesn't mean I am not personal with anyone, but whenever I saw a bald-headed man, I felt really that he was scalped. Then it was after a great trouble that I found I happened to see an Indian. And such are the stories told about different countries. Many who know great men of India, they think all Hindus are Christ-like. That is not true. But most Christ-like people I have seen in India, you read about Christ. I have seen the miracles of Christ with great souls in India. India may be poor. India may be disease-ridden. India is now free by political, by spiritual means. But in the same India, I have seen some men that you will read in my autobiography as I have never seen anyone. I was very sick. I was skin and bone. I always suffered from indigestion. I had a closet full of medicine, and about indigestion. And when I met my master, he said, "You have tried, these are all have power." He never condemned anybody. He had many doctors as his disciples. He never condemned anybody. That was his beauty. And he said, "But they have limited power. You have tried all these things, but they don't work. Why don't you use the unlimited power of God?" I said, "I have heard that, but it doesn't work." He said, "Yes, it will work today." Well, immediately I was healed. And the flesh began to grow upon me from next week. I had tried Binol, cod liver oil, everything, but nothing happened to me. Just his word. He had done great miracles for me, and I was a very skeptical sort of person, though I was born with certain visions and experiences. But still, I was very cautious. I even learned magic to see the difference between miracles and magic. And what I have seen about my master, there's no word can say. To come back to art of living, we must remember the paramount necessity is unity of language. English is already the lingua franca of the world. And I pray that India and every nation retain English as the lingua franca of the world. It is only when we hear somebody else talking in a different language we feel different. We must learn one language and keep our mother tongue as a secondary language. That will bring the unity in the art of living and the common scientific art of living. Then unity of religion. If there is one God and we are all his children, why should there be so many religions? There was a blind man, there were seven blind men who were washing an elephant. And after they washed the elephant, they were all fighting. One said the elephant was pillars, he had been washing the legs. Another said it was a string. Another said it's a piece of a wall, he had been washing the side. Another said it was a fan, he had been washing the ears. Another said, "Yes, it's a couple of bones." They were all fighting. When the driver came, he said, "My friends, you are all right and you are all wrong." Most religionists see only the part of the elephant of the truth. But the masters, those who commune with God, who see God in reality, who see the universe as a motion picture of the omnipresent light. When you see the motion picture, when you are engrossed in the drama, you do not know that there are shadows and light. The hero, the villain, is made so that you love the hero. Then when you look to the beam on top, then you will say, "Well, the hero and the villain are nothing but the made of the beam." That's how the light of God, as Eddington says, that would you believe that the man is made of 150 pounds, a man weighing 150 pounds, we say he is not matter. The atomic space between cells is far greater than the interplanetary space. And if the atoms in a man weighing 150 pounds were brought together, he will be invisible and could be put in a snuff box and he couldn't see him. But if we try to lift the snuff box, it will weigh 150 pounds. We are living in an age when the definition of the body, according to Columbia University, is that man is an electromagnetic wave. The whole earth is an atomic bomb. It has no weight, as you think. It is all made of light. It's only the one force pulling another creates the notion of way. God has fooled us with a motion picture which is not only true to sight and hearing, smell, taste and touch. Jesus Christ said, "Ye shall do greater things than these I do." We are living in a time when radar, radio and television, this television is mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita. One man was shown war from distance. And as Dr. Lewis, I lots of times see things. When I came in this place, I thought of everything at once. I didn't buy because of persuasion. And it became all true. And I said, "No more mortgages, Lord." So somebody came and prayed for this. So the thing is this, you can see the television in the ether. We are on the wrong side of the picture. The atomic world is most marvelous. You are the producer of wonderful things. How much more wonderful you are. India investigated that man. So by the understanding of religion, not only a scout or belief, but how man descended in the flesh, how man can ascend in the flesh. You know, in the daytime we become human beings, at night time we are all God, we are made in the image of God. How do you know it? Last night you were made in the image of God, you were sleeping in space, you are very happy, you are conscious, you know how you slept. But I say, at night time we are gods, in the daytime we become devils. And if in daytime we become gods, we are gods all the time. So meditation, calmness, introspection, and all these things emphasized by the East has one purpose, that we live like God in the daytime. As God reminds us in the night time, we are God. Sleep is not a jumping board to realize we are dreams of God. We are a motion picture of this universe. But that we may remember during the daytime, we are also that same happy being which slept internally. I won't go much deeper into it. I told of the unity of language, unity of religion, and brotherhood colony. I am not starting churches, another new cult. I don't believe in it. In our place, in Golden Lotus Colony in Encinitas and Mount Washington, we had these two trial colonies. We have several colonies in India. I never asked whether one is a Catholic, Jew, Gentile, Christian, whoever comes I take. If they have good character, good conduct. Some people of course come and try to reform us from the very beginning, while they require the reformation very badly. But we are very choosy now. I can tell you, in years we had never a quarrel. You see, I am a little bit superstitious. I never have to say, "Do this, do that." Or Stanley, who is the minister of this place, he has helped building most of these towers that you see. And what wonderful cooperation his mother and his father and he gave, and Mr. Jacob and others. I don't try to name. If I name, the others are left out. All those that have cooperated, what it was you have no idea, and what we have done and what is going to be, you cannot imagine. It will be a place, a flower land, with a wonderful museum. I have been given some of the costliest opals in the world. And there will be in display here, and many other rare stones. And this will be a shrine for all religions, that all may feel that unity of faith. I remember, for the first time, I want you to know that our church is the only church that calls church of all religions. two Catholic sisters came in our church in Hollywood. He says, we never heard that name. Go to it. You have our blessing. I thought I was very flattered when I heard that. Last of all, we must remember, we must emphasize one language. Also, we must have an international police force. Only non-violence would not do. For if you go into a tiger's cage and say, Mr. Tiger, I am going to practice non-violence on you, he will chew you up first before you can preach non-violence. In this world, we need a police force. And if there was ever a holy war, I believe, it is in Korea. That is my complete conviction. I told again and again many of the consulates in China who were our students that please write. I wrote to the State Department, if China goes, it will be the greatest disaster will come. Armed intervention will come. They laughed at me. But they don't laugh at me now. The great is a moment of great disaster. After this war, we thought everybody will be policed and everything will be all quiet. One world war went in China, another armed revolt in Korea. It is necessary for us to have a police force because all the people of the world are not educated enough to understand non-violence. Of course, as I said once, that in the Boston when the police struck, there were 80 holed up in 1 week. I said, look how little it is considering that there are thousands of people that had the opportunity to hold up people and didn't. Of course we want that state when police force would not be necessary. But there'll be always some people who will be wicked and we have to guard ourselves. And wars are unnecessary, we should make it unnecessary by cooperating with America's ideal. And I'm glad America and Canada and England, and I hope India joins fully in this great mission to have peace by all means. I know I have never seen a country like America which has helped all countries with millions of dollar imperialism. I said all America has to do is not to give anyone. That's nonsense. America has helped every country in the world. America has had no desire for aggression. So we must cooperate with her in every way for the sake of peace. And we believe and we pray that brotherhood come by peaceful means of Gandhi and not by force. But it must come by any means whatsoever. Last of all, I'll tell you a few stories that you will remember about art of living. We must build colonies wherein we can take the youth who are willing, 100% willing, to have job, happiness, freedom, and produce food for their own use. Some of the melons, the nicest melons that you see here, these have been grown by our boys. All our vegetables are grown by our boys, which supply close to 200 people. So we are not charged in the ordinary sense for 1 hour, we build a great big edifice and then we pray for people to come and sit. We don't ask. Whoever comes willingly, fine. Whoever doesn't, we don't cook. We want heart. I prefer a soul to a crowd, and I love crowds of souls. So the greatest thing in the church movement is the building of colonies to take the surplus of industry and to educate the American youth in character building. You know in your schools what deplorable states occur. Headmasters and principals come to me and say, how is it that your boys and girls behave so wonderfully without being told anything, and our boys do everything in the world? I say, because they are just as good boys, but you don't give them any training. They are afraid to give any training because they think it's either we have to introduce Catholicism or Protestantism. But all isms have one underlying principle, is character building. And that's what we are teaching our people. We are not making empty members, but all these souls that you see, they are wonderful souls. I have never seen like them. And they are doing this for sometimes 14 hours. I work 15, 16, 17 hours sometimes. And they also work the same way, gladly and happily, to advance the cause. And everybody is happy and healthy and well. That is more than all the money in the world can give. When I met Alvin Hunsicker, he said, I am disgustingly healthy, I am disgustingly wealthy. But I said, you are not disgustingly happy. And I won him. He became a disciple of the order. This sort of colony, I hope the governor, all my humbleness, emphasize character education in these schools and building of these colonies where they can have their job, home, character, church, and freedom at the same place. And I have found the greatest result by that way, that I have some people who have great executive ability. We are now starting we have started already a goat dairy, and another colony is starting in Phoenix. We have quite a few colonies in India. But the colony system is succeeding because it isn't a charge just for 1 hour, build a great big edifice, tie up so much money. You see, we have simple construction and beauty, but everybody, including minister and everyone, Reverend Bernard, whom you saw, that great big dome is much bigger than this. I said, you got to build the dome. He said, you don't say so. I said, Bernard, if I sit down there, you can do anything, because there is a great attunement. So he said, all right, I will. He had laid in his flesh, he didn't mind. He finished that dome. If you ever pass by and see it, see what a big dome that is. It is all done by our own people. That is the secret, that we must work for God and commune with God.
Bursting on the boundaries of heart. the flowers of my heart. In sorrow thrills I piped my love, I sadly sang my song to thee. And yet I knew my love must reach thee, though many lives I have to wait. On mountain crags of high devotion I sadly sang my song. Come down to me.